cry for me. In my Father's arms I'll be. The wounds this world left on my soul will all be healed and I'll be whole. The sun and moon will be replaced with the light of Jesus' face. And I will not be ashamed, for my Savior knows my name. Now it don't matter where you bury me, 'cause I'll be home and I'll be free. No, it don't matter where I lay, and all my tears be washed away. Gold and silver blind the eye, temporary riches lie. Come and eat from heaven's store, then come and drink and thirst no more. No, it don't matter where you bury me, 'cause I'll be No, it don't matter where I lay, 'cause all my tears be washed away. So weep not for me, my friend, when my time below does end. For my life belongs to Him, and who will raise the dead again? No, it don't matter where you bury me, 'cause I'll be
Well, good morning, Ecclesia. Happy Easter to you and your loved ones wherever you're gathered. I would love to start with a very traditional greeting that saints have used for literally hundreds of years to greet each other on Easter morning. And that's simply to greet each other with the saying, "He is risen," and then to respond with, "He is risen indeed." So I would love to just say that to you. So Ecclesia today, "He is risen." He's risen indeed, love it. So welcome. If you're like me, you're caught in this place where there's heavy things that are happening in your world or around you. And today is so helpful because it's a reminder of resurrection and redemption and hope in all circumstances. So I would love to begin our time today with just a prayer of gratitude and celebration over today and what this means for us and for all people. So would you pray with me? God, we thank you for a day to be alive, to breathe in and to breathe out, to receive your love and your grace. And we thank you for Easter Sunday and what it means for us and for all people in all times and all places, that no matter where we find ourselves, that the story is not over, that you're still working, that life can come from any and all circumstances. And so God, will you breathe into us today? May we breathe in your life. May you use it to produce faith and hope in us. And may you give us eyes to see the people that we can share this hope and this life and redemption and resurrection with. And we pray all these things in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ecclesia, we're so glad you're here with us today. God bless.
Ecclesia, this is Pastor Chris. Happy Easter. He is risen. I can't believe that we've gotten into a new year. The world is feeling so much more normal, and we get to celebrate Easter together. For whatever reason, you are worshiping together with us through the worship table, and I'm so thrilled that I get to share with you. As you likely know, if you dialed in last week, I am just back from a trip with a small group to the Poland-Ukraine border and then into Ukraine. Into Lviv to meet with pastors. And my heart and my mouth are just overflowing with stories. I feel entrusted. In fact, I just got a call from CBS this morning wanting to talk about what we experienced in the Ukraine. And I feel like I've been entrusted with some sacred stories. And the one I want to tell you today is really about what makes Easter, Easter. The beauty of Easter is not just the historical fact of who Jesus is and what he did and that he was resurrected from the dead. It's what it changes. And the truth is that Jesus was born into a world where the understanding of justice was really simple. It was an eye for an eye. It was a tooth for a tooth. And everybody, if someone hurt you, the standard was you hurt them back. Now, you don't have to be married long to know that this doesn't work. You don't have to have a friend very long to know that if when your friend hurts you, your response is to hurt them back. This is not a great way to live. And so you can imagine when I asked my dear brother and friend, Konstantin, a Ukrainian church leader, he's an NGO leader, he's caring for children, he's doing really brave things to feed people right now. And on a long drive from the border to Lviv, I got lots of time to ask Konstantin any question I wanted. And one of those questions were, how are you dealing with the anger? Because I can tell you when you're there. You know how when you're around somebody that's angry, you see it in their body, right? When you're angry, you feel it in your posture, in your neck, your face tightens in a different way. As we walked around the border of Ukraine, you could see every kid was angry, every grandmother. As Mitzi got to care for people in the tent, as people came into rest once they'd crossed the border. And Operation Blessing, our friends there, have a beautiful little tent and a rest area and a place people can get coffee and food and a little bit of help, and they can charge their phone. And volunteers like Mitzi get to pray with people and talk to them. And some of them were kids. You'd ask the kids, how are they doing? And you know how kids are. The best way for them to express themselves is through art and drawings. Betsy said every kid had one common theme in their drawings. They were revenge fantasies. Every drawing was about wanting to see Putin get killed. When I asked Konstantin, he said there's really two ways we respond. One, you join the army so you can go kill someone, defend your people. Two, he said our sense of humor has gotten a bit wicked. He said things that would have been inappropriate months ago now are just the standard. It's their way of coping, right? It's natural. The beautiful part of Easter is that Jesus absorbed the most heinous violence and he didn't respond in retaliation. I'm going to share with you today one of my favorite teachings of all times. It's on the Sea of Galilee. If you ever get to read a passage where it happens on the Sea of Galilee or in Jerusalem, it's a beautiful experience. And today I get to take you back there and teach you from that place. A passage that invites us to consider a Messiah that came and said, eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth is no longer it. We're going to love our enemies. We're going to love those that persecute us. And only in this way of living, this Jesus way of living, does the cycle of violence ever end. I get to teach you from my favorite passage in John today. It's a food passage. I hope it blesses you. And then I'm going to share a little bit more and we'll have communion together. Happy Easter, Ecclesia. Ecclesia, this is Pastor Chris, and I want to tell you Happy Easter from an amazing place. I'm on the Sea of Galilee, and today I get to teach you from John chapter 21. It's one of my favorite passages in all of Scripture, and I love nothing more than getting to teach you a passage from the place that it happened. This passage, it does a lot for me. It increases my faith. It does so much, but you know the main thing it does for me? Every time I read it, it makes me hungry. Now, for you, maybe you hadn't read it recently, but if you read it well, it'll make you hungry. Now, most of you are going, Pastor Chris, everything makes you hungry. You get hungry when you just drive somewhere because you pass the barbecue place. Yeah, I get it. You know me, that's part of my struggle. But this passage, I'm telling you, it prompts me to ask one of those questions like you would on a cooking show when you get a great chef and you want to ask him, like, what's the best meal you've ever had, right? And you expect just some amazing story. And often what they tell you is less about the meal and more about the person that made the meal. I can't wait to get to heaven and sit down with a guy named Peter and ask Peter, hey, Peter, you had some pretty cool meals, right? The Gospel of Luke tells us in Luke 4, you're off with Levi the tax collector. By Luke 7, you're having a meal with Simon the Pharisee. Now, those are two really different people, right? A few chapters later, you have a meal with 5,000 of your friends. That was kind of a miracle, happened just on a mountain over here. You have a meal with Zacchaeus. You had a meal in the upper room. You had this amazing meal. It was a little bit lopsided. You guys were hiding. You locked the doors. Jesus comes in. He appears to you for the first time, right? And what's he say? He says first, like, peace be with you. Peace be with you. Don't be afraid. Look at my hands and feet, right? First few things he said. And then he goes, do you guys have anything to eat? And you wonder, like, is like being resurrected, does it just make you super hungry? Or was Jesus trying to make a point? I don't know. Maybe one day we'll find out. My guess is Jesus knew whether he was hungry or not, that eating with his disciples was really, really important. And so, what amazes me in this story is that these disciples, when they were walking with Jesus, they usually couldn't figure out what he was saying. They kind of walked around like a bunch of numbskulls. Jesus loved them, but they didn't ever seem to get it. And we often will say, after the resurrection, they got it, which is true, but not right after the resurrection. In fact, what we know is that when Jesus appeared with them in that little room, and then he told them, he breathed on them, and Luke, it said he breathed on them. He said he gave them the gift of the Holy Spirit. And then he said, just as the Father sent me, I'm sending you. Now, you would think at that moment, they'd be like, we got an assignment, right? It's like Tom Cruise in the Mission Impossible shows. They give him here's your assignment. This is what you need to do. I'm sending you just as the Father sent me. Seems pretty clear to me. What did the disciples do? Nothing. Nothing. They didn't do anything. They didn't know what to do. They sat around. They sat around some more. And what we hear in John 21 is that about seven of them were together. They still weren't doing anything. They weren't trying to figure out how to start churches. Literally nothing was happening. And in John 21, Peter says these words that literally change history. Peter goes, I'm going fishing. The other six people were like, all other six disciples were like, all right, we're going with you. Now, we hear that story and we think they just got up and they went fishing. Well, you got to remember, they were in Jerusalem. From Jerusalem to Tiberias, where I am here at the Sea of Galilee, that's 91 miles. So can you imagine going down the road going, all right, we're going fishing. We just got to start the 91-mile walk. They're walking 91 miles. Can you imagine? You're walking 91 miles. All you can think is, I can't wait to be fishing. And I get why they wanted to go fishing. When I mess up, I often want to go do something that I'm good at, right? So if I'm going to go play golf, I'm lousy at golf. I don't feel so good about myself after I play golf. I feel a little better if I go preach at Ecclesia because I'm better at preaching than I am at golf, right? If you're a really good golfer and a really good preacher, I just want to tell you, I don't think that's fair. But Peter, he'd blown it. He'd absolutely blown it. He denied Jesus. He didn't feel good about himself. What do you think he wanted to do? I want to go do something I'm good at. I'm a good fisherman. So let's go fishing. So they get there and they fish and they fish and they fish. They've been waiting. They've been talking about it for 91 miles. We're going to crush it when we get to the Sea of Galilee. We're going to catch so many fish. And what happens? Nothing. All night long. And then they hear, right here in these waters, they're about 100 yards out. You can still see the boat. You can call out to it. They hear this guy tell them, throw the net on the other side. And they're thinking, what does this guy know and who is this guy? And they throw the net on the other side. And you know what happened. They knew that wasn't just a guy. That net was so filled with fish. It tells us that Peter had a shirt off while he was working, what a fisherman would do. And he threw his shirt on and he went swimming into Jesus, right? And then Jesus told him, get some fish. He went back and he got the fish and it said he counted 159 large fish. Now hear this, Ecclesia. The first thing the disciples learned about the resurrection was that if you want to do things on your own, you can fish 12 hours, zero fish, right? Not very effective. 1 minute with Jesus, 159 large fish. I don't know what you're doing in your life, but my guess is if you'll live into the resurrection, the story of Easter, what we're going to learn is we're more effective if we do it with Jesus. Jesus does the most loving, caring thing. And he pauses, he takes the fish, he cooks it over a fire. He spends quiet time with Peter and the disciples. And he does what Peter desperately needs because Peter's blown it. So Peter, he wants to go do something he's good at, right? He wants to distract himself from his failure, just like you or I would do. If you fired off an email saying things you shouldn't, you weren't present, you weren't thinking, or you said things to somebody you wish you could take back, or you blew your temper with your kids, and you realize they did something wrong, but you were way more wrong than they were. You may blow it. You may feel this sense of pain and shame and sorrow for what you've done. And the instinct is I'll do something I'm good at just to distract myself. But what you really need to do is deal with the pain and the shame and the sorrow and the guilt. And that's what Jesus was offering a chance for Peter to do. You know he must have sensed it when he could see Jesus off in the distance as he's carrying the fish over to him. He's carrying the fish to Jesus. And he sees the fire and he smells the smoke. You know the last time Peter saw Jesus at a distance, right? He was being court-martialed. He had people around him questioning him, and Peter hung off at a distance. And it tells us as he was being warmed by the fire, he denied Christ again. Jesus not only cooks for Peter, he makes him this beautiful breakfast. And he turns to Peter and asks him three times, Peter, do you love me? And Peter replied, of course you know I love you, Lord. And in three different ways, Jesus said to Peter, feed my lambs, tend my sheep, take care of my sheep. Ecclesia, my suggestion to you today, whether you sent off a hostile email or you lost your temper with your spouse or whatever the thing is that you know, if you can't come up with 10 things that you've blown it in the last year, in the last month, some of us in the last week, this is what I'd love for you to do today. We do the same thing that Peter and Jesus did. Jesus is asking, straight to you. He knows you by name. Do you love me? as we worship, as our brother Propaganda inspires us and calls us into the resurrection story, as I get to open the scriptures with you today in person, as the band leads us in song, what I'd like for you to do is let your heart go to those places and say, Lord, where have I failed you? Because I want to get rid of shame, because this is what I know. If we live in shame, we'll live in distraction. We'll be out there catching nothing. We won't be effective. But when we lean in with Jesus and we follow his call to take care of his sheep, feed his sheep, take care of those he loves, we find that we're the people we're made to be. It wasn't just the resurrection that changed the disciples. It was when Jesus took time to make clear to Peter that the resurrection changed the reality of his shame. And when Jesus recreated that environment where he had denied him three times, and instead he had the chance to affirm his love three times and to be given clear instructions, take care of my sheep. Ecclesia, we're those people. As we join our voices together in song, as we celebrate God's grace and goodness today, will you join with me now as we worship? Ecclesia, can you imagine having breakfast with Jesus on the Sea of Galilee? That the man that you loved, that you saw dead and buried, has resurrected, and he's come back, not to rally an army to attack the people that hurt him, but to forgive the people that hurt him. Not to give Peter a hard time for the ways that he's failed, just to forgive him. Ecclesia, Easter is a reminder that you're forgiven and that I'm forgiven. We don't have to live with any shame or any guilt. One day I hope you can join me and have that breakfast on the Sea of Galilee. At least you got it virtually today. This summer, July 22nd through the 30th, we'll be taking another trip. We're gonna stay in this hotel called Magdalitz in the hometown of Mary Magdalene. And we'll get up one morning and have that breakfast. God has blessed us with forgiveness. And maybe you didn't hear it the same way that Peter did on the Sea of Galilee, but I hope you hear it today from Jesus, from your pastor and friend. And that we remind our brothers and sisters in Ukraine that we love them, that we support them, and that we walk together in this journey. So as we come to communion, I want to invite you wherever you are to break your bread. Ecclesia, this is the body of Christ broken for you. Christ loves you. You are beloved. And I pray that as you celebrate this day, that you celebrate it, basking in his love and forgiveness, that you let go of all shame and all guilt. This is the cup. And it's the blood of Christ shed for you. As you drink it today, may you be reminded that Christ has called you to live in joy and in happiness. Ecclesia, let's celebrate this day and celebrate it well. Wherever you are and whatever you're doing, know that you're loved. God bless you.
Amazing grace, how sweet. The sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas great. Yeah.
Ecclesia, we're so grateful that you have joined us for this celebratory Resurrection Easter Sunday. Please receive these words of our benediction. In the dark of the early morning, it descended. The very breath of God. Dawn approached. The Spirit filled the lungs of our fallen king, and his heart began to beat anew. At the rising of the sun, he awoke. He opened his eyes. He smiled. He rose, victorious. They say the tomb was empty, but we know otherwise. Fear and shame left behind. Sin and death left behind. Our old ways and our old selves left behind. Forever entombed by Christ the Son. So go forth to live and serve in the name of Jesus who has conquered the grave. Jesus who is risen. Jesus who reigns. Hallelujah. Go in joy and celebration. Ecclesia, we love you. Go in peace.